So, catalyst browse, does it destroy your footage? Well, it can, but doesn't have to. Let's talk about it. So for people who have watched this channel, and we should all be watching the channel, we're having a great time over here. Come on in and join the party. But Catalyst Browse is something that I like, I use all the time on my little ZV-E10. It is a free software from Sony where you can take the gyroscopic data that is recorded in some of the Sony cameras and then run it through that software and you get gimbal-like footage. It does other things as well, but primarily I use it and most people use it as a stabilization software, and it does an amazing job. But there's been a lot of questions about whether or not you can use 10-bit in the free Catalyst Browse, or if you would have to upgrade to the paid Catalyst Prepare, and are they taking away features now and hiding them behind a paywall? And so I'm going to answer all those questions. In fact, I'll answer some of the questions. Now, the Catalyst Browse, you can go right ahead and update that. The new version has all of the functionality of the old version. There's just some stuff written there that makes it sound like maybe they took away a couple of features if you read it the wrong way, but no, it is still fully functional as you always expected it, and it's just they did a big update with the FX3 for Catalyst Prepare, so they updated Catalyst Browse as well. But enough dilly-dallying, let's go over to the old computational device and I will show you actual footage.
So here we are in Final Cut, and I have my little ZV-E10 over here, and my studio, there's my light right there, but it's all off right now, and you can just see my sound blanket, which is really a moving blanket. Anyway, here we are to see if Catalyst Browse destroys your footage, and this is Final Cut, and right now the clip you're looking at is one that was rendered in Catalyst Browse. Now I will go to the original clip right here, and there it is. That's the original clip. Did you see any change? Because I don't really see a change. And let's go on over to a side-by-side, and as you can see, still pretty identical. I'll just play it here a little bit so that you can see it side-by-side. And now we'll cut in about 200%. And now here's where you can see a little softness. Catalyst Browse is on the right, the original clip is on the left, and you can see that the original clip is a tiny bit sharper, but again, we're in at 200%, and I find that if you sharpen, just as say in Final Cut here, even their default is too sharp to make it. Now it's sharper than the original clip. So I find that as long as I put the sharpening at about 1.5 on Final Cut, it is virtually identical then. But still, this is at 200%. For all intents and purposes, you're not really gonna see that much of a difference. Now there are a few transcoding options and I'll go through them here. I even have the 10-bit 422 because I purchased Catalyst Prepared for this test for you guys, spending money, can you believe it? So this is AVC and is one of the transcoding options. Now we're on Intra, looks the same. AVCS looks the same. And now here's the long 422. So this one is the 10-bit 422 output from Catalyst Prepare. Again, it looks the same. And here is the original clip. So unless you're doing heavy color grading, you're really not gonna see any difference. Now, don't get me wrong. If you need that 10-bit footage, you're only gonna get it in Catalyst Prepare. Again, we'll talk about that in a second. But right now, let's move on to Doug, little ZV-E10. So what happens with your 8-bit footage in the ZV-E10? Well, it's good news, really. This is the clip, which is the XAVCS, which is the default, which is what it is shot on. And then you take it off, identical. It looks exactly the same. And again, we have a side-by-side here. I will play the side-by-side just so you can see. That sound a little musical. I'll play the side-by-side here. I should have some nice music going. Maybe I will in post. You don't know me. Probably not. I'm too lazy. Now we're going to go into 200%. Now, once again, you can see that the original clip is a bit sharper than the Catalyst Browse. So you do lose a tiny bit of sharpness. I can't guess as a percentage as to how much, 5%? I don't know. But you have to zoom in to 200% on my gorgeous eyes in order to see any kind of detriment to your footage. But now here's something where you'll see a bigger difference, and that is in the 1080 footage. So on the ZV-E10, which has pretty soft 1080 to begin with, if you toggle between the two clips, you can actually see the sharpness increasing when you go to the original clip. And this one here is the Catalyst Browse rendered ABCS clip, and here is the original, and you can see it is sharper side by side. You can probably also see the sharpness when you go side by side here. And certainly when you zoom in to 200%, here is where, you know, neither image is super sharp because it is 1080 after all, the soft 1080 on my little ZV-E10, but definitely the Catalyst Browse rendered clip is softer than the 1080. Makes a little bit of sense. The A7 IV and the 4K as well in the ZV-E10. They downsample one from 7K, which is A7 IV, the 6K in the ZV-E10, but the 1080, not downsampled, you know, it's gonna be soft. So now let's talk about the 10-bit in Catalyst Prepare. I shot the sky, beautiful shot I have here of the sky. I color graded the crap out of it until I had the sky banding and breaking apart there. The color's just going bananas. So this is my 10-bit 422 footage from the A7 IV. I transcoded it in the XAVCS codec. That is both available in Catalyst Prepare and Catalyst Browse. It will look exactly the same. I've tested it many times. But if you use Catalyst Prepare's 10-bit 422 output, then as you can see, the banding goes away. So you get your dynamic range back from your 10-bit footage, which is essential for a lot of people when they're color grading. And just to show you the original clip, that is underneath it right here. And this is the original clip looking pretty identical to the 10-bit 422 output. And just to show you that you can't do 10-bit footage in Catalyst Browse, even if you use the intra codec. A lot of people thought if you just output it in intra, then it's going to be 10-bit. And it's true when you look at something like the VLC player and then you put in an intra file and then you go take a look at the, where is it here? The media information. You will see it says it's a 422 10-bit file, but that's really, that's just the container. That is not really, you can do that with your 8-bit footage as well. If you take a ZV-E10 clip and you run it through Catalyst Browse and you use it on intra, it will say it's a 10-bit 422 file. The same way as if you recorded an 8-bit file to an Atomos Ninja 5, then that's ProRes and it will look like it's 10-bit, but it's not. It's just 8-bit wrapped in a 10-bit container. Do you know what I mean? You still only have 8-bit footage. It's just you're in a 10-bit container. You got a small amount in a big bucket. And to prove the point, here is the original clip and here is the old Catalyst Browse because I have both versions. I was worried about upgrading the new version because some people were saying it was taking features away. So here's the old version and look how much dynamic range you lose when you play it. There's banding in the sky, you're losing all that detail in the clouds. The same thing with the new version of Catalyst Browse. It has the exact same situation. And even in Catalyst Prepare, the intra is also, you know, it definitely not 10-bit footage. But if you go to the 10-bit 422, now look at that, see, there goes the banding, and now it looks like the original clip again, because this is the 10-bit 422, which is real 10-bit, whereas the intro was giving you a false sense that you actually had 10-bit footage.
So now I will show you some clips of actually walking around in society, because that is how you would use Catalyst Browse, and perhaps that is where some people are running into difficulty, because there are certain settings you should use to make sure that you have optimum motion blur or lack thereof. Let's go ahead and watch that.
Okay, so check this out. I am at 1/200th of a shutter speed because Catalyst Browse does not like motion blur. Picture when you're taking a photograph and you want to freeze the action, you up your shutter speed. So it's the same principle with Catalyst Browse. So you do a faster shutter speed And when you record that gyroscopic data, you're gonna have some crisp footage that will look nice and smooth, as opposed to this. So now I'm at 1/50, which is often the way I shoot my footage because I have 24 frames per second, so you double your shutter speed, generally speaking. But as you can see, there is motion blur in my face hole, and it's creating just what looks like unsharp, unstable footage, weird footage. So up that shutter speed. And just in case that didn't work, this is 1/50 with exaggerated motion. I'm bouncing up and down to make sure that you see how the footage will get all blurry and weird. So here we'll do a test with active stabilization because A, you can see how the active stabilization compares to the catalyst browse, and B, we can see if catalyst browse does anything wonky to the footage in terms of sharpness compared to the old active. It should be pretty close in terms of crop factor because I think the active stabilization crops in about 10%, and I usually do about a 10% crop on catalyst browse. Let's find out. And so now this is on catalyst browse, and I just realized in terms of lining up the shot with the last shot, I had to hold my arm in exactly the same spot. So hopefully I am doing that. Now you may notice a slight bit more background blur in this particular shot. That's because I upped my shutter speed to 1/200, as you should do with catalyst browse, which turns this lens down to f1.4 in order to expose the same way that the active stabilization shot was. So a little bit extra. I kind of like that catalyst browse. Usually when I'm out in the sunshine, that's when I need catalyst browse. So upping the shutter speed is usually a benefit to me because I can then lower my f-stop to get more background bokeh. So with all this said, what do you do? Let's just load up catalyst browse here, and I will show you it's pretty basic, really. So let's grab any old clip here, this one here, this 1565. Now I will go down to the little film strip with the shake on it. I will say stabilize, and then when right here, the minimum cropping ratio here, I do 90%. I always do 90%, and it comes out great, in my opinion. This is where some people were confused. It says manual mode and minimum cropping ratio are not available in Catalyst Browse. Upgrade to Catalyst Prepare to enable manual mode. But this is talking about lens breathing compensation, and that is upcoming in Catalyst Browse. That's not even available, Catalyst Prepare, I'm sorry. That's not even available in Catalyst Prepare currently. They will be implementing the lens breathing thing, and that's the thing that you won't be able to have the minimum cropping ratio on. The regular manual cropping is good to go. Anywho, then you go to your output here. I like to rename the files. The browse is put it wherever you want to so that you won't lose it. And I like to keep the clip name, and then I put at the end like catalyst browse, you know, and then I know that it's my catalyst browse clip. In the format, you just choose same as source, and then you'll see the frame size here. It's a 4K thing. And then the render preset, it sets it here. If it says it's 60 megabits per second, then go down to the 100, click on that in case that happens to you. And then you export, and that is it. And it takes a few seconds, or depending on how long your clip is, a few hours, it just depends. And in Catalyst Prepare to get the 10-bit footage, it's pretty much the same, except you just change one little thing. So let's go to another clip. We'll stabilize this one. I set my cropping ratio to 90 as per usual. Then I'm going to export. Here is, I do the same thing. I rename the files with the clip name, and then, you know, maybe we'll write in prepare. So now I know it's my catalyst prepare file. And then same output color space, same as source. I don't touch that. Now the format, you do XAVC long, and you make sure the render preset is down on the last one, which is XAVC long 422. And then you know that you are going to output 10-bit 422 footage and keep all of that dynamic range.
So now remember to turn all stabilization off in your cameras when you want to use Catalyst Browse. You can use the active stabilization and it will still record the gyroscopic data on some of the cameras, but the problem comes in when it's standard stabilization or if the lens has stabilization. And even if you're recording and you do get it recorded with the active stabilization, it's already cropping in on your footage. Now you're going to have to crop in further. Plus, the stabilization in the camera is going to sort of compete with the stabilization in Catalyst Browse. What I'm saying is turn off all stabilization to be safe, and it is going to give you your best results. Set your shutter speed to about 1 over 200. You can also get away with 1 over 125 or 1 over 100. And so now you see another limitation of Catalyst Browse is that when you're upping your shutter speed, you are going to decrease the amount of light you're getting in. So in low light situations, Catalyst Browse is not great. And also when you're in a room with artificial lights, a lot of those flicker very fast, and your camera will start to see that flicker when it ups its shutter speed. When you're using your 1/50 shutter speed for say 24 frames a second, you're not going to see that flicker in the lights, but as you up your shutter speed, you probably will. So if you're in a situation where there's artificial lights, again, Catalyst Browse may not be the right call due to the higher shutter speed. Now you could just drop your shutter speed back to 1/50 and deal with the fact that you may have a few weird artifacts with motion blur. Up to you. Always use 4K because the 1080 footage is just going to come out too soft. And if you want to shoot in 10-bit 422 and really get all of that dynamic range, you're gonna have to upgrade to the Catalyst Prepare, which is a paid monthly subscription. I really wish Sony would let you use the 10-bit footage. I mean, we're buying A7IVs, A7S3s, FX3s. I just think that that should not be behind a paywall. I think that make Catalyst Prepare a very robust program that would be compelling so that we'd want to use it and then gladly pay for it. But the 10-bit, I think that that's something we're doing these days. A lot of us are using our 10-bit cameras, and people like me really like using the gyroscopic data. So I definitely want to use my 10-bit footage and get my full dynamic range. And I hope that Sony is listening and makes that available in the free version, because I don't think that's too much to ask when we're buying the super expensive cameras. Oh, and a little quirk I noticed that might help you guys out if you're doing it. If you have Catalyst Browse or Catalyst Prepare open and you take an SD card and you put it into your computer there, and then you load a new clip, then Catalyst Browse or Prepare, they might not see the gyroscopic data. I had to close the program, start it up again, and then it saw the new clips having the gyroscopic data. Just a little glitch that I saw that you might want to be aware of. You might think, oh, I didn't record my gyroscopic data, because that's what I thought earlier today, but turns out I did. So does Catalyst Browse destroy your footage? I don't think it does. No, I think that you lose a tiny bit of sharpness, but if you dial in the right settings, you can get excellent results. Sure, I would love to have the 10-bit. That would be very nice, but I am glad that this is available as something that you can use to smooth out your footage. I know for me, it has been very helpful, and hopefully this video was helpful for you guys. If you have any questions, leave them in the comments below. I will do my best to answer them now. If you don't mind doing all these tests and checking all this footage, it is now 1 a.m. and I have not yet started editing this video for tomorrow. So I have to go. I'm starting to sound like Bill Cosby here. I gotta go now. We'll talk to you again soon. Okay, bye-bye. Oh, and since you're still here, why don't you check out this video, which should be of great interest to you. Great interest.